Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. It's a pleasure to be here once again, 2 weeks in a row here with my church family at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church. I pray that God will be with us as we delve into His Word a little deeper. Before we begin, let us say a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank You for bringing us into Your house of worship. I pray, Lord, now as we spend a few moments in Your Word, that You'll forgive me of my sin, touch my lips, hide me behind the cross. You know that I am unworthy, but I pray that Your Holy Spirit will speak and that we will be blessed and we will see You more clearly, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Last week we talked about trees. And we looked at some Old Testament references to certain trees, and we talked about the tree of life there in Genesis. We talked about the tree of knowledge of good and evil, and we looked at the burning bush, which I called the tree of fire. And we talked about how in the tree of knowledge there was a presence of choice that the Lord provided, the promotion of character, and the protection of life. And the tree of fire also showed us the presence of God, the promotion of God, and the protection of God in Moses' life. Today we're going to shift and move over to the New Testament and talk about another set of trees. Now when I think of trees, we're going to talk about three trees. It's the tree of action, the tree of connection, and finally the tree of redemption. Growing up, I used to have a neighbor that had an extravagant treehouse. Anyone ever had a treehouse when you were growing up? Anybody? And as you look at treehouses that they have on HGTV, they far and away are different than the treehouses I remember as a child. And when you think of a treehouse, of having a house in a tree, the immediate picture is not this, is it? Or what about this? Talk about living in nature, a tree literally in your house. And these extravagant structures that they're able to put together, thank you, engineers, as you're able to construct such wonderful things. I used to have a neighbor that had a house not as extravagant as this, but more like this. All right? A little A-frame roof and four sides and a little rope ladder to climb up. His name was Matt, and me and my friend, Ebby, we used to go to his house to see that treehouse, and he had a cool treehouse like this, which to us was amazing. And from that treehouse, you could also jump on a zip line that he had that would be able to go down to the ground. I mean, it was so cool. So me and Ebby were really inspired by this treehouse. And so when I think of trees, this is the first thing I think of, is my treehouse. And my treehouse, it was kind of a tree that kind of looked like this. This is an exact one. It's a little smaller, not as branchy. And, of course, we weren't going to be getting something that looked like that because me and Ebby were going to construct it. And as we're as young kids, you know, I'm going to say between the ages of 10 and 13, something like that, we're in our backyard exploring. Remember the time of exploring? You just go in the backyard in the woods and we're exploring, and we found one of these wonderful things. It was a wood pallet. And this wood pallet, we saw it and we saw the potential of that wood pallet. And so what did we do? We ripped off all of the pieces of wood on it because we're woodworkers. No, we didn't. We just stuck that thing in the tree. We literally took that wood pallet and just stuck it in a tree that would, in a place it would fit. It was like, it was kind of slanted. And we nailed it as best we could. And we just sat on a pallet in a tree, but called it a treehouse. Those are good times. There's another guy that decided he was going to sit in a tree as well. And his name was Zacchaeus. And as we go to the story of Zacchaeus, we think about, when people think of trees, it's probably the most famous tree, the sycamore tree that Zacchaeus went into. And as we read it in there in our scripture reading, turn with me to Luke chapter 19, as we're going to talk about this tree of action, is what I'm going to call it for today, a tree of action. Turn your Bibles to Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19, And as you go there, you'll notice that Luke tells us the profession and stature and status of Zacchaeus. He's a chief tax collector. He's not just a tax collector, you know. He's a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And when the Bible calls out certain aspects about a person, it really wants you to focus on that, because it was prominent about that person. And so here, Zacchaeus' position is one of tax collectors, and tax collectors in that day were rich. And you know why. We've talked about this all the time before. They were appointed from the Jewish people to collect tax for the Roman government, and it was a tax on the Jewish people. And of course, you take a little on the top, right? You're in the 13% tax bracket, 10% tax bracket, and you know, you're going to add a little 2% tax, and that's the Zacchaeus tax. He gets a little bit extra. And so the connection between he was a tax collector and he was rich is the line that draws them together. And the Bible tells us in this verse that when Jesus passed through Jericho, remember, he's passing through Jericho. You got that, right? They're on their way to Jerusalem. And here, as he's passing through Jericho, there's a crowd with Jesus going on this way to Jerusalem. Now behold, he says, there was a man named Zacchaeus, who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to do what? See who Jesus was. But he could not because of the crowd, for he was what? Of short stature. Now this happens a lot, right? We now have made him the short man. Unfortunately, even the song goes even further by saying, Zacchaeus was a wee little man. I mean, come on, it says short stature, but the kids have now learned he's a wee little man, and then you didn't get that? And a wee little man was he. This poor guy. We don't know his exact height, but something about him not being able to see above the crowd, or maybe just get a glimpse of Jesus, for he was short in stature. So the Bible says, so he ran ahead, climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for Jesus was going to pass that way. Now, what would drive a man? This is a grown man who is a chief tax collector, who is rich, who's probably dressed very well, to decide, I'm going to run ahead of all of these people and I'm going to climb a tree. I mean, he's not a little boy. He's not a teenager. This grown man decides, I'm going to climb a tree. Now, the sycamore tree is like what they call, scholars say it's a sycamore fig tree. In that area, it's very common to be along the roads. This is where they say that's the Zacchaeus tree, the one in the bottom right. But it would look, the one on the top left is kind of like how trees would be, right? It's low. It's not like he had to go, and I see this when I go to India, when they climb up the coconut tree. Like, he wasn't doing that, trying to get up the tree. It would have been low trunk, gotten up, and the branches kind of spread out so you can look over the road that was passing underneath. And so Zacchaeus climbs up there. And I want you to imagine this in your mind's eye, this grown man, maybe in something what was equivalent to a suit back then, dressed well, climbing up a tree and sitting in it. What would cause this man to run ahead of a crowd and climb a tree? Because the Bible says he just wanted to see who Jesus was. What, you wanted to see what color hair he had? How he dressed? What is it that you're trying to see, Zacchaeus? What is it that you're trying to gain from this experience? You're sitting in a tree, bruh. Like, what are you going to say to him? But just to catch a glimpse, what drove this man to take such drastic measures to just see Jesus pass by? He did not think Jesus was going to stop and talk to him. I mean, he's hated. Why would a rabbi take time and stop to this tax collector stuck in a tree? Mrs. White says this in Desire of Ages, page 553. The wealthy customs officer was not altogether the hardened man that he seemed. Beneath the appearance of worldliness and pride was a heart susceptible to divine influences. In this chief of the publicans was awakened a longing for what? A better life. a better life beyond what than being rich. Come on, that's what we're all trying to do. Zacchaeus, you're rich. Can you imagine? Just to get a glimpse what this man was doing, what was going on in his life, that he would finally go. Have you ever thought about the fact that he had heard of Jesus? This occurs in Luke chapter 19. If you go a little further than Luke 19, it's a triumphal entry. Jesus heading into Jerusalem. This is going to be the last week. Had he heard in the past 3.5 years, close to Jericho, close to Jordan River, not too far, had he heard John the Baptist preaching about this lamb? Had he heard about Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead? Had he heard about all the healings? What was it that he was wanting to see about Jesus? Had he heard that a tax collector was actually one of Jesus' disciples? Did he see a little bit of a possibility that he could be accepted where in a society he was not accepted? What was driving this man? But we hear here that his heart was susceptible to divine influences. What people saw on the outside about him was not visible. What was going on inside of him was not visible to the people outside of him. But the Spirit was working. There are people in your life you may not be able to see God working in them. They may seem like they're the furthest that God could reach, but within them there is some longing for a better life. As you hear of the pain and the suffering and the hurt in this world, let me tell you, there are people that will see it, and I hope they can say, there's got to be something better. This must be something better. For what he had right now, he said, it's going to drive me to go do something I thought I would never do. Did he have chances to see Jesus before? Probably. I mean, it's not like he just moved there. He's a chief tax collector. And the thing about it is, was this going to be his last opportunity if Jesus was going to die very soon? He decided to go. He could no longer endure the contempt with which he was often met by with his own countrymen. And it seemed to cause Zacchaeus to feel like this was his chance to take some action. He says, I may have been thinking, I've been sitting on my hands, Jesus has been around, I've heard about him, I've been interested, but I've never really took the step to try to just go see him. I have the ability, I have the means, I know where he might be. I mean, people are talking, he's preaching, but I just haven't gone. So this grown adult scurries his short self apparently to a tree he could climb just so he could catch a glimpse of where he knew Jesus would be passing by. My friends, are you willing to sometimes seem ridiculous and cross any vale or mountain, climb any tree to simply get a glimpse of Jesus where he's passing by? Like Zacchaeus, it could change your life. Or is it the fact that it's a little cold outside that we just can't make it? Could it be that we're just a little too tired to go meet Jesus and be where he will be passing by? Are you willing to climb, like Zacchaeus, the tree of action? You see, there are opportunities in your life where you can get close to Jesus, where you can be where he is. That's what we say, it's important to spend time. The importance of church is not because church in and of itself will save you, but it's because where we come to meet together to meet the Lord. If it were not for church, I'm sure if we were going to be sitting at home, we'd be having a lot of errands to run. If it were not for the Sabbath day, we may still be out there hustling and bustling, but it gives us the opportunity to be able to catch a glimpse of Jesus. Don't take that for granted. Like Zacchaeus, it could change your life. You see, sometimes when we think of things that we do to get closer to God, I say, God, I want it to be a revelation. If it's not hard-hitting, I mean, it's not enough. But sometimes those glimpses, little pieces, are all we need. Peace after peace. And if we seek after simply that which is always going to be enthralling, we're just tickling that little part of us and humans that wants to be entertained. But like Zacchaeus, if you would for a moment say, young person, I've felt the tug of God and I've just kept letting it go. Stop doing that. You have the ability to climb the tree of action and step out and say, I'm going to go where I can get a glimpse of Jesus. Yes, you can do that at home, of course. You know, we open up our Bibles, He is the Word, and I'm not discounting that fact. So whatever it is, in whatever part of your life, I pray that you would just get a glimpse. Stop closing yourself off to the work of the Holy Spirit and climb a tree. Take a step and see how God can work. Because look what happens to Zacchaeus. He thought it was just going to be a 30-second meet and greet. I see Jesus. Okay, he's kind of cool looking. All right. Oh, looks like a man of sorrows, actually. And as he passes by, all right, I got to go back home. But his life changes because look what the Bible says as he goes to the tree. The Bible tells us Jesus stops. Man, this grown man looking down at Jesus, like, man, what a scene that was. And all the people are like, what is going on? And Jesus stops. And he says to I don't have it up here. It says it in verse 19. And when Jesus came to that place, he looked up and saw him. This is verse 5 in chapter 19. Zacchaeus, make haste, quickly, come down, for today I must stay at your house. So Zacchaeus made haste and came down and received him joyfully. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will do what? I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me. My family and I, you know, one of the things we do best together is eat together. No matter what the occasion, it could just be the smallest thing. It's like, oh, I guess we got to go out to eat for this, you know? Because the time that we spend eating together is just, the food brings people together at a time when the kids would want to necessarily maybe go play some video game, but food? Okay, I'll come, you know, kind of thing. And here Jesus goes and he says, look, I'll stand at the door and knock. Here Zacchaeus gave Jesus the opportunity to knock at his door. He opened it and Jesus was his house guest. Do you want Jesus to be your house guest? Sometimes it takes when you have the ability to climb the tree of action and just get a glimpse that Jesus will come by. And you know, the Bible says there in verse 7, they all complained saying he has gone to a guest with a man who was a sinner. They complained about it. People are always complaining about stuff, right? Like, there's really no reason to complain. Are you just jealous that Jesus went to his house and not yours? I pray that when we find Jesus coming to a house, no matter whose it was, you say, praise the Lord. He may go to the house least expected. I encourage you, parents, keep praying for your children. Maybe they're not in the church now. Maybe they don't know God. Maybe they've gone away. They know him, but they've left. Don't stop praying. The Spirit will work. He continues to work, so don't think that that will not happen. As you go through and we think about the next tree, the tree of connection, we're going to get into the meat of the message today. This is that true vine. We heard in the Bible question today, it was one of the seven instances in John where Jesus says, I am. In John chapter 15, he says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me, you can do nothing. Here Jesus talks about a tree that is a vine. And I think of it this way. As you, we've recently moved into a house and you're setting up, I was setting up my home theater system here, you know, speakers, my TV, you put it all together. And you know, one of the things, unfortunately, still you have to do is plug stuff in. And Uncle Anil and the media team knows this. Wire management is a difficult thing. You that may not know, do not see all the wires that are actually running through this entire place. Being able to power these lights, power the lights, get the stream going over here, you don't see it, but it's all there. And one of the things that becomes difficult is you keep plugging stuff in, right? You plug it in, and then here I am trying to get everything set up, and I turn it on, and nothing's happening. But everything is plugged in. And I try to wonder to myself, like, what's going on? You know, you start driving yourself crazy. You unplug and plug, like that's going to make a difference. You keep unplug, plug. And then what do you have to do to try to figure out what's going on? I didn't realize that when I was using the surge protector, right, where you're plugging all of the stuff into, the surge protector wasn't plugged in. I can be plugged into this thing as much as I want, but if that thing is not plugged in, it doesn't matter how great the TV is or how nice the speaker is, that thing will not turn on. There is no power that it can receive. When Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches, he's saying, look, you can plug into a lot of stuff, but if you're not plugged into me, if that's not plugged into the power outlet, you can be the prettiest TVs anyone has ever seen, but you are lifeless. There's nothing, maybe larger TV than someone else, it may be an OLED, doesn't matter. Because that TV is just a piece of plastic that does absolutely nothing unless it's plugged into the right place. Here you have grapevines that grow. This is a pretty cool one that I saw online, different types of grapes. But look at that, right? When I think of I am the vine, you are the branches, that's it right there for me. The church, like, goes out, and from that one vine, you got all these branches. And as we think about what Jesus is saying here, he says, oops, I abide in me, for apart from me, you can do nothing. Abide in me is to abide in my love. And he says it there, if you look at chapter 15. He says, if you abide in me, verse 7, and my words abide in you. Then he says in verse 9, as the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. To abide in Christ is to abide in his love. And we abide in his love by keeping his commandments, which allows us to bear fruit. What is it that you're abiding in right now? You see, what the Jews were doing when he was speaking to them, it's Ellen White says in Desire of Ages, the Jews based their hope of salvation on the fact of their connection with what? Israel. Keep that clear. See, she says they thought their salvation was based on their connection to who they were as a people, not to Jesus. But Jesus says, I am the real vine. So the soul dead in trespasses and sins receives life through what? Connection with Christ. We can think that attending a particular church is the thing that will save us, but it will not. We may think that keeping the Sabbath is the thing that will save us, but it will not. It is connection with Christ that saves us. It is not your creed or where you're from that will save you. It is connection that will save you. That's what Jesus is saying here. The natural result of disconnection from the tree of Jesus Christ is loss of life because he is the source of life. And the other thing people find out is when we think there's a better life, some say, they're so enamored with heaven that they will do whatever it is to escape the suffering of earth. And that's where I say some of us are seeking salvation rather than connection. You see, some of us are saying, well, I just want to get to heaven because I heard it's kind of nice there and there won't be all this pain and suffering. But we don't want to be connected to God. Are you in that place? Are you in the place where you say, I want to be saved, but I don't want to be connected? I crave salvation, but I do not crave connection. And Jesus is saying, that's not going to get you anywhere. You have to abide in me. He's encouraging us to seek connection, which leads to salvation, as opposed to making a God of just salvation. Does that make sense? All right? Instead of just trying to be in heaven, whether God is there or not, is no matter to you. But that is not heaven. Charles Spurgeon says this wonderful thing where he says, even if hell were the place God resides, I would be there. He's not enamored with this concept and idea of heaven. He wants to be where God is because that to him is a heaven. I pray that we will see that connection. Whatever it is you do, connect, connect, connect. And God makes it so clear. Jesus makes it so clear. He says in verse 9, as the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. He doesn't ask you and I to abide because if we don't, we will die. He does not ask us to abide because if we don't, he'll be upset. He's saying, abide in my love. See that love, and it will change your life. sometimes we get, I used to be like this, like, why does the Bible keep, people keep talking about love, 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 like, you know, why don't you talk about the hard stuff? And we try to protect God from himself as if to say, well, if we just talk about love, people are going to take advantage of God's love. It's not your prerogative to protect God from God himself. I used to think like this, well, if you tell them that, well, the Bible is replete with it. So much so that we're told, Ellen White tells us, it will be the study of the ages to understand the infinite love of God. And so when we come here and we see what he's saying, he's like, can you get plugged in to that love? Can you come here, and when that, the way you show that love, he says in verse 10, is by keeping my commandments. Plain and simple. And we'll get to why that makes sense in the next one. Now, Jesus says, if you do this, let's see if I have it here. Let's go back here to the verse. He says in verse 5, he who abides in me and I in him does what? Bears much fruit. Now, I'm not a green thumb, but I'm pretty sure that if you're like growing a grapevine or a peach tree and it does not produce fruit, it's not really a grapevine or a peach tree. Are you with me? Like, the whole point of it is that it should provide fruit. And what if, I thought about this before too, like, what if the tree never released its fruit? Like, it was there, but you could never pluck it. You just saw the tree, and like, that's a beautiful tree. Look at that fruit. And you try to go pluck it, and it just does not come out. Is that a useful tree to you? No. Sometimes we can be trees that have fruit, but no one is allowed to pluck that fruit. It's all for me and myself and maybe a little bit of my family, but I'm keeping it all to myself. I'm going to just, this fruit is for me. But God never intended for our fruit to be that way. And what is the fruit that he's talking about? The funny thing is he says, Jesus does not say you need to labor to bear fruit. How do you bear fruit? By abiding in him, right? It's not by doing church work. It's not by reading my Bible per se, right? I know that's a part of abiding in Christ, but not the work of doing it. But the actual connection to Christ will automatically, through that plugging in, will allow us to bear fruit. Does that make sense? But what is that fruit? You want to know the difference between a person who wants to be connected to Jesus rather than just saved by Jesus? It's their fruit. When they're actually connected, there will be fruit. John 15, verse 2 says, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he does what? Takes away. And every branch that bear fruit, he prunes or cleanses that it may bear more fruit. And then verse 8 says this, by this my Father is glorified, that you do what? Bear much fruit. So bearing fruit glorifies God. And so as we see this, you might think to yourself, doesn't this sound familiar to something? Verse 8, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. You remember John 13, 35? John 13, verse 35 says this, by this all will know that you are my disciples. If what? You have love one for another. That's why he says, if you abide in my love, that love will then be replicated in the love you show to others. When you connect with me, love will flow to those that are around you. That's why I can't say some things as good as she does. So I'm going to say in Desire of Ages, page 678, it says this. The command to love one another had a new meaning in the light of his self-sacrifice. That's Christ. During every hour of Christ's sojourn upon the earth, the love of God was flowing from him in irrepressible streams. All who are imbued with his spirit will what? Love as he loved. Woo! Oh my. All who are imbued with his spirit will love as he loved. Is that true in your life? Have you been connected to the tree of Jesus? The tree of connection. Have you gone there? And if so, you can tell. Because there will be fruit. And that fruit is for others to be a part of. Are you with me? A fruit is to be taken from the tree and eaten. And then when it falls, it produces more trees. Are you with me? More connection. I pray that as you go through your life, there will be the fruit of love. That those that you come to, that you will seek Christ, not for simply salvation, but for his connection. And as you do, all will love as he loved. May that be true at Remnant Seventh Day Adventist Church. May that be true in your household. May that be true in your families. May that be true when you go to work. May that be true when you go to school. May that be true through eternity. And others will follow and find out, what tree are you connected to? I need to know a little more about that tree, and we'll lead more to Christ. Our next and final one for today is the tree of redemption. I'm sure you know where I'm going with this final tree. The Bible says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a what? Tree. Interesting thing is that the Bible then goes on to tell us that in 1 Peter 2, verse 24, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might what? Live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. Jesus' death on a tree brought life. But why did Jesus have to die? What about our sin caused his death? And how does his death then bring us life? Seems like a basic thing. But I want us to think a little further about it today. 1 Peter says he bore our sins. But what is sin? What do people say? Transgression of the law. It's the one we talk about, right? Transgression of the law. So did Jesus' death for... I need you to think. I'm going from preaching to teaching now. I want you to think. Did Jesus' death for our sins simply satisfy a bloodthirsty God that needed some blood to be shed? Is God now appeased of his anger because Jesus died? And this is an all-important question to settle, or else we will understand what Jesus actually accomplished on the cross. Did Jesus, all he do was that say, well, God needs someone to die, and Jesus is going to be the one? Are we putting the God of the Bible in the same place as the Baals and the Asherahs, saying, well, we just need to appease this God so he's no longer angry. He just needs something, anyone, a firstborn available? You see how we can start mixing up what pagan religions we're teaching and how we understand what God is trying to accomplish. Now, he does need to speak to us in ways that they could understand. But the lamb itself was a symbol of what would happen. But the Bible tells us, desire mercy, not sacrifice. Are you with me? The cattle on 1,000 hills are mine. I'm not appeased by the blood of bulls and goats. So God, why are you doing this? What is it about Jesus' death that brings life? We need to figure out, what is sin? Is sin simply bad behavior, broken rules, and disobedience to a law? You see, if we don't understand the problem, we may take the wrong treatment. When you go to a doctor and you're not seeing a person and taking their word for everything and saying, you know, some people like to do this because they've gone on WebMD already, so they already know what they have, and they just need a doctor to give them the medication they need. But you were not asking for the doctor to simply provide a treatment for your symptoms, right? You're seeking a treatment for your sickness. And when someone has pneumonia, that's the picture up here, they have symptoms of cough and fever. But cough and fever, are they the problem? No. What your normal OTC drug products do is they get rid of the symptoms, but you still have the sickness, right? They help you stop coughing and lower your fever, but sickness is still there. And so, if the pneumonia is treated, the cough and fever will be resolved. Amen? So I have to treat the sickness, and then the symptoms will go away. If sin is simply bad behavior, are those not just the symptoms of the sinful condition that I have? Think. If all Jesus was trying to accomplish on the cross was say, hey, I want you to stop your sinning, I want you to be able to stop the bad behavior and leave us with the sickness, are we any better off? The healing had to come not to cover the symptoms, but the defect in character that we have. Sin is therefore a state of being, a defect, a deviation from God's heart of love. You see, sin as a condition, I know it's also defined as sinful acts, but I'm defining it as now a condition that is opposed to love and clings to selfishness. And if not cured by God, it, the sin, will result in eternal death. Does that make sense? It is not my sinful acts per se that are the ones leading me to death. It is the sin within me, that defect in character that shows up in the lying and the cheating and the manipulating, that needs to be cured in order for me to find life. Does that make sense? But the way to get to sin now is we need to define what is the law, because you guys defined it, sin is transgression of the law. How do we view this law? Well, there's two ways, there's more, but I'll talk about two ways this is often viewed. Number one, the law is a legal set of rules people are required to adhere to upon threat of penalty. This is often how we think about the laws of our land, right? Right? If I go and park in the no parking spot, because I'm just going to go in real quick, you know, just real quick. How does a meter maid come so quickly? I mean, I just was on for 2 minutes when they come out, but see, the threat of penalty, $50 fine, you parked in the wrong place. I got to pay the fine in order to clear my debt. Are you with me? And when you view it this way, it shows the law as something was disobeyed, and in order to be just, God must now impose a penalty because you get what you pay for, right? You do the crime, you pay the time, right? So this is the way, and we're talking about God's law here, right? Is this the way to view it? If God, in this view, sin is rule-breaking, which is bad behavior. So Jesus is the legal substitute. My bad behavior is transferred to Jesus, and now he pays the price of God's punitive justice, thereby paying my debt. And now that the debt is paid because Jesus was killed, we are forgiven. And you can see, I know in some of our minds when I was going through this, is we have that kind of concept somewhat, at least bits and pieces of it. Oh, Jesus, of Isaiah 53, he bore my sins, and now God is satisfied, so now I am forgiven. But is that true forgiveness, right? If someone says, hey, Auntie Sadhana, you owe me $50, but gift paid your $50, so I'm forgiving your debt. Hold on. Is that me really forgiving your debt? No, someone else has paid the debt, and I got what I needed. Do you see what view number one makes it seem like, right? You did something, you paid for it, okay, fine, I'll forgive you. I'm satisfied because I got what I need. Let me flip it just a little further. So view two would look at it this way, that the law is a principle emanating from the Creator. And deviation from this principle is incompatible with life. So in this view, what if sin is more than just breaking rules? It's a damaging condition that kills people, and it makes sense. There's no one you could go to and say, hey, what if I told you, let's go to a place, and this is going to be the rules we'll follow. We're not going to lie to each other. No cheating. We're going to respect each other's property. I'm not going to covet. I'm not going to take things that aren't mine from you. I'm going to treat you with love. I'm going to treat you like I treat myself. And you know what? When you need something, I'm going to be generous with all that I have to be able to help you along the way. And there's not going to be any affairs. We're going to have full trust and love between one another. There's going to be no broken homes because we'll all be in this together. We'll watch out for each other. There's no one, not even the atheist, would say, I don't want to live in that place. I'd rather live in where I am right now. Are you with me? The concept of the law of God is that it is the thing that will bring life. And so, more than a legal payment, a cure was needed for the disease that we have. The Bible calls God's law in three different places the law of love. Romans 13, Galatians 5, James 2. And this definition makes sense if we understand the law is a transcription of God's character. And 1 John tells me that God is love. So therefore, his law, which is a transcription of his character, must also be that which is love. Makes sense? This is the way that God constructed us, to be ones that will operate on the principle of love. And for this reason, he has instructed all life to operate. You see, sin is taking rather than giving, selfishness rather than selflessness. And this way of living inevitably leads to death. Does that make sense? You can see that in the world right now. It's apparent. The greed with which people live is damaging to so many, because I will get more and you will have less. The principle of God's law is one in which he's trying to show us, when you look at the law, it diagnoses your condition, because it shows you how to properly identify sin and reveal to you your sinful condition. Does that make sense? When I look into the law of God, that is the way to live a life of love. And in it, I find I do not do that. Therefore, there must be something wrong with me. There must be some condition, because I try in Romans. Paul tells us that, right, in Romans. The thing that I want to do, I can't find myself to do. And the things I don't want to do, that I keep on doing. And there is this law of sin within me. And so it's not just the actions, it's the condition. That's what I want you to understand. Am I okay? Let me get a head shake. A lot of times what we do in church is we just say, well, stop doing that thing. Well, that's kind of nice. But you got to go a little further than that. Because the sinful condition at some point is going to make you cough again. It's going to cause you to have a fever again. Jesus is not a OTC drug product. He's not the NyQuil you take at night so you can feel better for the morning. He is the ultimate cure for the sinful condition. Therefore, you will not have that cough or fever no longer. You see, Jesus is the cure. As he came to show us the truth about sin, Satan, and God on that tree of redemption. By seeing Jesus, we see the truth about our condition, about what it does to the human person. The true evil of sin is identified, and the love of God is personified. Jesus did not simply come to pay our debt to satisfy some legal requirement. He took our condition upon himself that he could cure our terminal sickness. He wasn't taking half measures. At least you'll have a good week because you have no more symptoms. No. He says, I want you to have eternity without this condition. He took that upon himself. That's why Isaiah 53 says he bore our griefs and our sorrows. We were the transgressors, but he took our condition that we would no longer have to live apart from God. My friends, your terminal sickness has been put to death. You see, our acceptance of Jesus' sacrifice attests that I am truly saved by grace, because he took my sickness and he nailed it on the cross. Not just my sinful acts, but my sinful condition. And it is by faith we hold on to Christ and we say, I accept your sacrifice, Lord. I accept that you took my sinful condition. And as such, through you, I have victory to live a life of love. Are you with me? It's so much deeper. That's why the Bible says, I came here to bring you life, and life what? More abundantly. This abundant life is one in which I don't just cease from doing sinful acts, but I get cured from my sin. Ultimately, that will be shown to us when we get to heaven. But I want you to know that when we accept Jesus, it's not just that he's saying, oh, I'll give you power to stop, you know, doing this. Yeah, the Holy Spirit gives us power. But he's saying, if you take this cure, sinful condition is what I'm there for. What's his name? C.S. Lewis says, God is one in which he says, you may want half measures, but I don't do that. When he comes to fix something, he demolishes the whole house and builds it up again. You may want something less, C.S. Lewis says, but God says, I can give you nothing less. It is a whole transformation. What marvelous grace is it that he who called Zacchaeus down from a tree would be raised up on a tree and draw all people unto himself? What marvelous grace is it that he who went to Zacchaeus' house on earth is now calling each one of us to his home in paradise? It is amazing when we find ourselves and see the grace that God shows by saying, no, I'll do it. And in the Christian, the God of the Bible says, I will pay that price. I myself, God says, will take on the sinful condition. And I, through taking on your sinful condition, will finally put it to rest. The Bible says, sin will not rise up a second time, my friends. No. I get this question a lot from young people. I stand on the truth of God's word, and it's not going to happen. Not going to happen. We will know, we will see on the cross, as we look at Jesus, we find that the lies of Satan are now destroyed. He had said that God was doing it, and he needed you to die, and he's a vengeful God, and he cares not for you. But the Bible tells me, while I was still a sinner, Christ demonstrated his love toward me. The Bible tells me that he gave up his riches, took on my poverty, that I may gain his riches. What marvelous grace is it that we serve a God who says, I'm going to make you wholly clean. I did not give you this law in order that you may measure it with each other, that you may be able to judge one another. But I wanted you to see through this law that you have a condition. And in order for me to show it to you, I gave you this. And see that now that you have a condition, will you come to me, because I am the cure. I will take it from you. My friends, I pray that you will climb the tree of action and do all you can to get as many glimpses of Jesus as you can. Do not take the glimpses for granted, whether it is here or there, through a piece of music, whether it is when you're on the road and you say a quick prayer, whether it's a time that you can come for Bible study or prayer meeting on a Wednesday that might seem inconvenient to you. I pray that when you can, you will take those glimpses, because you do not know how much longer you will have glimpses of Jesus. We take it for granted. I pray that in your households, you will give your children glimpses of Jesus. And not just pawn them off to their teachers in school or their Sabbath school teachers in church, but that in your home, you will provide glimpses of Jesus, that they too will see, ooh, there's something different. I want to learn more about this Jesus. Climb that tree of action. I pray that you will endeavor to seek connection at the tree of connection this week as you abide in Christ. I pray that you will see your Savior on the tree of redemption as he bore our sin and put our sinful condition to death. He overcame death. Marvelous grace he showed to a sinner like Zacchaeus at the tree of action. Marvelous grace he showed to his disciples at the tree of connection. Marvelous grace he shows to you at the tree of redemption. May we appreciate our God today and every day by seeing the trees. Amen.
hymn of dedication is number 109, Marvelous Grace. Hymn number 109.
Father, we thank you for your grace. And I pray for each person within the hearing of my voice, Lord, that we will seek to take action to draw closer to you, that we may be connected to you and every day contemplate the redemption you accomplished for us on the cross. Lord, I pray that as we go through this week, that we will be doused with your love and your grace, that we may share it with those that are around us, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for your grace. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, and thank you for joining us today once again for our divine service here at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's been a pleasure and a privilege to worship with you from wherever you are. We know that we have family all across the world, and I want you to know that we consider you a member here part of this family at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church. Today, our very own Pastor Reggie Samuel gave us a powerful message, a part two of the two-part series, See the Trees, in which he explained and expanded on the metaphor and analogy of trees, pointing us to a good way to live life, reminding us of the condition of sin that we are in and we are combating, and also helping us to fix our eyes on Jesus, who sacrificed so much, everything really. God sent His Son to save us. May we see the trees, may we recognize the lessons in nature, and may we also remember that in this word there is the promises, there's so much to gain, that we may have life more abundantly. If you've been blessed by the ministry here at the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church, it is my hope and prayer that you continue to pray for us, that you continue to share our message with those around you. And as well, if you'd be so kind to donate to the Remnant Seventh-day Adventist Church, we would much appreciate it. We have invested $50,000 into bringing an updated audio and visual experience for our church members, our brothers and sisters, and our families all over the world. While the congregation, while our members here live are paying off the mortgage, I request that you, our church family abroad, help us in paying off this loan that we have taken, investing in God's work. This afternoon we'll have praise and prayer service at 4 p.m. I hope that you can join us. But until then, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift His countenance upon you and give you peace, dismissing you today with His blessing, but never from His presence. Amen, and happy Sabbath.